Good morning, beloved, and welcome to our service this morning. Once again, it is always such a privilege to be able to share God's word with you and just be in communion with you as fellow believers and the saints of our Lord Jesus Christ. Our call to worship this morning is taken from Psalm 34. Hear the word of the Lord. I will extol the Lord at all times. His praise will always be on my lips. I will glory in the Lord. Let the afflicted hear and rejoice. Glorify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. Let us pray. Almighty and sovereign God, we thank you for the privilege of being able to gather together as your saints. Lord God, we thank you that in the midst of the hustle and bustle of this world, we can have this time to just revel in you, Lord God, to praise you and glorify your wonderful and most holy name. So, Lord God, we pray this morning that our eyes would remain fixed on you, that we would hear from you through your word. Lord God, that you'd remove any distractions from our midst, that our focus would be on our worship of you. So, Lord God, I pray that you bless the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart, that it would be pleasing to you, that it would fill your saints with the hope and the joy like no other. For you are our God, and we are your people. This we ask in your wonderful and most holy name. Amen. We'll be starting our new series this morning, which will be doing an overview of Paul's letter to the Colossian church. So our focus this morning is on Colossians chapter 1, verses 15 to 23. Hear the word of the Lord. The Son is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For in him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities. All things have been created through him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together, and he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning and the firstborn from among the dead, so that in everything he might have the supremacy. For God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in him, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross. Once you were alienated from God and were enemies in your minds because of your evil behavior, but now he has reconciled you by Christ's physical body through death to present you holy in his sight, without blemish and free from accusation. If you continue in your faith, established and firm, and do not move from the hope held out in the gospel. This is the gospel that you heard, and that has been proclaimed to every creature under heaven, and of which I, Paul, have become a servant. Just so far in God's holy word this morning. And I've entitled my sermon this morning, Reconciled by Christ. Beloved, this morning we are going to be looking at Paul's letter to the church in Colossae, which was located in the Lycus Valley, alongside Laodicea and Hierapolis. Scholars tend to argue that Paul actually wrote this epistle while he was imprisoned in Rome, around 62-63 AD. And from the reading of this epistle, we will very quickly pick up on the fact that Paul was indeed writing to challenge the false teachings that were spreading through the church. You see, beloved, there were those who began to teach a blend of Jewish and Greek philosophies. The teachings became a combination of Christ and self, Christ and other angelic beings. They did not rest on the complete work of Jesus, which is one of the clearest evidences of a heretical teaching. And the reason for this is simple. We cannot add anything to Christ's complete work of salvation. Not by our works, not by our attempted law keeping, not through saints or angelic beings that intercede on our behalf, not through what we eat. The only thing we add to our salvation is the sin that made it necessary. Christ stands supreme and unique, for in him is the fullness of God. He is the very image of God. It was through him that the created order came into being, and he is the sustainer of all that is both seen and unseen. He has satisfied the demands of the broken law, and he has the victory over all the powers of evil. As Paul mentions in verse 13 and 14, for he, that is God the Father, has rescued us from the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of the Son he loves, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. And so as we turn our attentions to Colossians chapter 1, verses 15 to 23, we will very quickly learn of the supremacy of the Son of God. As Paul reveals to his readers Christ's deity and his marvelous act of salvation that can be found in the Gospels. First, we'll be looking at verses 15 to 20. Christ's reign is supreme. And then verses 21 to 23. Christ's reign is sovereign. So, turning to our first point, Christ's reign is supreme. Beloved, Jesus Christ, the Messiah, is the only perfect representation of God. And though for centuries people have tried to make images of God, these images fall far short and actually deface the glory of the incorruptible God. Just listen to the words of Romans. For although they knew God, they neither glorified him as God, nor gave thanks to him. But their thinking became futile, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Although they claimed to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images made to look like a mortal human being, and birds, and animals, and reptiles. You see, in Christ, God's glory is perfectly seen because he is very God and he is supreme. And though he is described as the firstborn over all creation, we must be careful not to fall into the trap of thinking that Christ was merely a created being, as many a heretical teaching insists. But rather, we must understand Paul's desire to underline the Son's preeminence. He is begotten of the Father, not created. And as the firstborn, He is before all creation. Dr. Lightfoot emphasizes that here it is the Son in his eternal being who is being described, rather than the Son as incarnate, an image that is made clear in the first chapter of John's Gospel. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. And so, to further emphasize the supremacy of Christ, Paul stresses that Christ was and is at the heart of all of creation. He is the agent of all creation in the visible world, and he is the agent of all creation in the invisible world, the heavens and all the heavenly beings. All things are created through him and by him, and are therefore subject to his control. And as Dr. Tasker puts it, he, that is Christ, is not only the agent, but the very goal of their creation. They exist with a view to his glory, and so are subservient to his eternal purpose. And so, far from being in any way a part of creation, Jesus is before all things. And this is not only in the sense that he is eternal, but also that his very being raises him to a unique position above all and before all, due to the creative act of God. The philosopher may seek for a principle of coherence, a unity amid all the diversity of the world of sense. But in the Son, the believer finds the true principle of coherence. It is Jesus' power alone that holds all of creation together. And beloved, as believers, we should find great comfort in the fact that Christ, who is the Lord of all creation, is also the Lord of the church, his bride. He is the firm foundation on which the church is built, and it is his truth that we are called to proclaim, for it is Christ that will direct and control his true church. Because he is the head of the church. As Dr. Tasker says, true unity and effective endeavor in the body of Christ are due not to reorganization of members, but to a renewed obedience to the divine head. And we would do well to remember that Christ is the very fount of the church's life. Beloved, Jesus is the Lord of creation, and he is the Lord of the church, and he must be Lord of your lives. For it is only in Christ that we are made new, freed from sin and corruption. Because in Christ, who is God, we see the fullness of God, lacking nothing, but completely righteous and holy. And because of his righteousness and holiness, we, that is all who submit themselves to God, are reconciled to God. And this is all because of Jesus' sacrificial death on the cross. Christ, by the offering of himself through death, accepted the curse that was due to us. The curse that was due to both you and I. By his death, he brought a sinful, fallen people to a position of fellowship with God. Point two, Christ's reign is sovereign. Beloved, where in verses 15 to 20, Paul emphasized God's far-ranging plan of reconciliation through Christ, he now applies it directly to his readers. And at the heart of this is God's ever-present grace in the lives of those he has set apart, even while they were still estranged from God and were indeed hostile to him. And beloved, this is something that is seen in all who turn away from God. The sinful, self-centered attitude is the source of all rebellion against God. And this will leave people in the tragic position of being spiritual outcasts. Because remember, we cannot serve both God and self. Our devotion must be to God, and he will care for us. He will reconcile us to him and move us from a place of being alienated and foes of God to becoming members of the household of God. And this is all because of Christ's complete work on the cross. It was not by some angelic mediator, but by the incarnate Son of God, who by his death effected the return to the status of fellowship with God, for which he had created humanity. Because remember, beloved, the ultimate aim of reconciliation in Christ is that those who submit themselves to God would be presented before God as holy and righteous. As it is written in the book of Romans, if God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also along with him graciously give us all things? Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who then is the one who condemns? No one. Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who is raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus, our Lord. And this should not lead to any spirit of complacency or slackness, but rather a heart filled with gratitude and hope. Because God, who has ordained the end, has also ordained the means, which is continued faith and trust in him. It is faith in the face of every temptation and trial, knowing that we have a firm foundation in Christ. And though there will be those who corrupt God's word by their false teachings, we need not fear. As the rain and the snow come down from heaven and do not return to it without watering the earth and making it bud and flourish, so that it yields seed for the sower and bread for the eater, so is my word that goes out from my mouth. It will not return to me empty, but will accomplish what I desire and achieve the purpose for which I sent it, says the Lord. Beloved, God is in perfect control of all things, even when we do not think so. And by his word, through the truths of the gospel, we will have peace. We will have joy. We will have hope. For we live in light of Christ's complete work. He has accomplished all that he came to accomplish. And he stands victorious. Beloved, the gospel of Jesus Christ is the good news that God has provided the way for mankind to be freed from the penalty of sin. Everyone dies physically, but those who believe in Jesus Christ are promised a resurrection into eternal life. Those who reject Christ will not only die physically, but will undergo a second death, which the Bible describes as an eternal lake of fire. Jesus is the only one in whom salvation can be found. The gospel of Jesus Christ is the best news anyone will ever hear. And what a person does with this news will determine their eternity. Beloved, God is calling you to choose life. Call on the name of the Lord. Repent, believe, and be saved. Let us pray. Almighty and sovereign God, as we come before you this morning, we pray that you hear our hearts, Lord. Lord, where we lack conviction, we pray that you bring about conviction. Lord, mold us, shape us, transform our hearts of stone to hearts of flesh, so that we can be more like your Son. So that in a world that so desperately needs your love, we may be imitators of that love. In a world that so desperately needs Christ, may we be an example of Christ, leading your people home to you. And Lord God, in our own lives where we lack belief, guide us, help us, sustain us. Lord, we believe. Help us in our unbelief. So, beloved, in this moment of silence, I challenge you, commit your life to Christ. May your faith carry you through. Lord God, hear our hearts, hear our cries for mercy. Come, Lord Jesus, come. And this we ask in your wonderful and most holy name. Amen. Beloved, we thank you so much for joining us this morning. We do hope that we will be able to gather together soon. Now receive the benediction. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Go out into the world and love as the Lord Jesus Christ has commanded us to love this day and forevermore. Amen. Have a blessed week and may God be with you.